Raiden and I always talk to you about following the numbers when it comes to investing in the stock market. Today, we bring to you Mark Hulbert, an expert who writes articles for Barron's and MarketWatch.
Super excited to have him with us today. In fact, he talks about his contrarian point of view, meaning if you think everything according to the news is going to be up, it's probably going to go down. And we can see that in a vice versa type of scenario. But we are super excited to be able to have him on and be able to do a nice interview. We've been telling you that we have created a texting hotline, if you want to call it that, so that you can text us any topics you'd like us to cover, any questions you have. We're glad to be able to text back and forth with you on that, as well as being able to make future episodes on those questions. You can text us at 984-207-1753. We hope you enjoy the show. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our podcast today. We have a very special guest with us. We're excited to have with us Mark Hulbert. And, you know, I have read Mark's articles now for quite a few years in MarketWatch, and super excited. He's written for MarketWatch, Wall Street Journal, Barron's. He has been in the New York Times business section. He's written all kinds of different things when it comes to markets and how to look at those. And I just find that when I read his articles, that I get a lot of, you get your mind off of what you're thinking that you're hearing in the news, and you get away from that thing you might hear on some financial news show, and you start looking at numbers, and it just helps me and my brain kind of get things together. And so, Mark, we are super excited to have you with us today. Thank you for coming on and having a conversation with us.
Well, it's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Good. So, hey, Mark, we'd like to just kind of get a little bit for our listeners to be able to get to know you a little bit. Can you just, first of all, just describe what it is that you do as far as what that is for everyone?
Well, I'd be happy to. I'll try to make a long story short, a lot shorter. I started in 1980 tracking the performance of investment newsletters. So this is back in the era when people like Joe Granville were big names. He was on the cover of a front page, I believe, of the New York Times. I think he was probably right. He was the only newsletter editor that was ever on the front page of the New York Times. There was a lot of attention being paid to newsletter editors, more so than I'd say right now. I think the newsletter industry has probably suffered, as most media has, under the internet. But back then, there was a lot of attention paid, and yet no one was tracking their performance. And so I had the reaction I think a lot of people did, which was, it wouldn't it be fun to keep track of how much money you would have actually made or lost if you did what they told you to do. And the only difference between them and me was that I was at a stage in my life where I could do something about it. I was just out of grad school, and a couple friends put up the money, and I had the time. And so I just started subscribing to a number of these newsletters, constructing model portfolios according to what they were recommending, and reported how much these portfolios made or lost. So that's the core of what I've been doing, believe it or not, now for over 40 years. I hate to say it's been that many years, but that's how long I've been doing this. In 2002, I sold my company. It was the Hulbert Financial Digest was the name of the newsletter that I published. I sold it to CBS MarketWatch. And then that website was in turn bought by Dow Jones in 2005. And so I've been part of their operation now for close to two decades. You mentioned in your intro that I was writing for the New York Times prior to that, and that's true. And even prior to that, I wrote for Forbes. So I've been writing for a number of different publications, but the one unifying theme is that I take what I consider to be somewhat of a contrarian perspective on the day's news, which is why I think you and others have that reaction that you mentioned, which is that it sort of takes you away from being obsessed by the day's news. And I followed the lead of a guy named Humphrey Neal, who wrote a book 100 years ago called The Art of Contrary Thinking. And one of his famous lines is that if everyone thinks the same way, they're probably wrong, or something to that effect. And that's not always the case, but it usually is. By the time everyone's jumped on board a particular trade or a particular strategy, most of the big profits, if not all of the profits that will be realized by that strategy or that trade, have probably long since been exhausted. And so what I do is remind people that when things look really good, they're not necessarily gonna, you know, be good forever. And the same way when things look pretty bad, I remind people that they're not always terrible.
Okay, good.
Great, Mark. Thanks. That's a great summation of, you know, how you got to where you are today. So of all that, what would you say, what do you love most about what you do right now? Is it, you know, the difference of the way that you look at the markets?
I think that's a big part of it. I think a lot of it also is that it's one of the most intellectually challenging areas of life. I know other people, I'm not one of them that, will go into sports betting, or whether they go to Vegas and try to be a card counter on blackjack. There are a number of ways in which you can challenge yourself to try to figure out how the world works. This just happens to be one that has particularly intrigued me. And I think it is ultimately fascinating. And we're all humbled by the markets over and over again. And yet we come back trying to see if we can figure out some way to do better the next time. So I'd say that's probably one underlying motivation. Another is just to understand the statistics behind the market, that there's so much data out there, and much of it is random, it's just noise, but there are regularities. And the challenge is, can we figure out where those regularities are and differentiate them from the sheer randomness that otherwise dominates the markets?
So one of the things that I was, even drew me more to as I did research on you and your statistics, your services, was I was looking at this and I started looking you up, and I went and found out and I said, he's in Chapel Hill. And, we're in Raleigh. So that was like, that's a super connective. But where did you grow up? Are you from North Carolina?
No, actually, I grew up in Kansas and went to college in Philadelphia. I went to Haverford College back in the early 70s, and then went to grad school at Oxford in England. And it was where I graduated from there in 79 was when I moved back to the U.S. and went to Washington, D.C. And I attended one of these big investment conferences. I was mentioning how newsletters were attracting so much attention back then. There'd be these huge investment conferences that were probably the precursor to the internet. It's where thousands of people would get together and different newsletter editors would get up and speak and so forth. And that was my exposure to the business. And so I stayed in DC, 25 years, and then moved down here with my family to Chapel Hill in the early 2000s. Mm.
So that's really great. I say we dive right in, Mark, and thanks again for being with us today.
Oh, my pleasure.
We've been looking forward to this interview quite a bit. You mentioned one thing about there's so much data out there in the markets, and I think for our viewers to really get a nice baseline of understanding, I think it would be prudent for us to talk about the different types of data that we look at in the markets, and I think if we can discuss the difference between fundamental investing and then technical analysis.
Yeah, it's interesting. When I started in 1980, I thought that my data might provide an ultimate answer as to what's the best approach to the markets, only to discover that in the right hands, almost any approach probably can work, and in the wrong hands, almost any approach probably won't work. So it's focused my attention more on the discipline and the patience that people bring to whatever discipline that they approach that they take in the market, rather than thinking that, you know, technical analysis doesn't work, or it does work and fundamental analysis is worthless. Mm. I find that those grand pronouncements will get attention. You know, if I write a column saying that, it'll get a lot of traffic, but it's not helpful to make those grand pronouncements. And so I focus more, I think, is probably a helpful avenue of approach, is simply what is it that we bring to the table in being disciplined and following whatever approach. I'm not being particularly original in saying, I mean, technical analysis probably works best over the shorter term, but doesn't really help you over the longer term. And it's just the reverse for fundamental analysis. The analogy for fundamental analysis that I find that is most helpful is from Ben Enker, who's one of the heads of GMO, the big firm up in Boston. But he likens the market to a leaf in a hurricane. We don't know which way it's going to go over the short term, but we know eventually it'll land on the ground. And I think fundamental analysis does, in the end, provide that gravitational pull to the market, just like gravity does to that leaf in the hurricane. But it can take many, many years for that market to submit to that gravitational pull. So I, you know, so for me to say that fundamental analysis doesn't help would be to say gravity doesn't apply anymore, which obviously it does. But on the other hand, it can take so long for it to, for the market to submit to that gravitational pull that clients and may find that it's way beyond their tolerance level anyway. And so you can't ignore any particular approach, I don't think.
Yeah. So could you tell us like what prompted you to start the Hulbert Financial Digest, like how that evolved? And then could you tell us a little bit about what that actually is? I mean, what data you are tracking?
Well, sure. I mean, the newsletter, on the record, say that it came to an end in 2016. Unfortunately, Dow Jones had bought CBS MarketWatch, and they decided that they didn't want to be in the newsletter business any longer, and so they closed it down. But I continue privately to track a number of different investment newsletters, and so I want to differentiate my performance tracking on the one hand from my newsletter on the other hand, which no longer is published. But basically that was the core, that tracking was the core of my newsletter. So I would set up these model portfolios and I created on my computer or on our network, because we had several employees having to help us out do this, but we created a simulation of the real world to the extent we can ever simulate the real world. So we got data feeds from all the exchanges, and we take into account bid-ask spreads and dividends and splits and corporate actions, you name it, everything you would need to know to see how much your portfolio does over time. And then we just let the chips fall where they may. We would track each one of these newsletters. If they had a telephone hotline or a fax or an email or posted on their website a change to their portfolio, we would immediately make a change to the portfolios we have on our computer. And then just at the end of every month, report how much money those portfolios had made or lost over the previous month or quarter or year or what have you. So we have data now going back to 1980 for some portfolios. Now, of course, most newsletters that were around then are no longer around today. And then, of course, vice versa, most that are around today weren't around then. But nonetheless, we don't throw away the data. So we have all of this enormous database on what strategies have worked and which ones have not.
Gotcha. So primarily to kind of sum up what I got there, the Financial Digest is to really gather a bunch of information as far as trades that are being made from a lot of other institutions, a lot of other money managers, and essentially find a trend maybe as far as what is working and what is not working.
Well, that's interesting. The trend part I'll mention in a minute, but you know, you got it right. That basically that we're just like a Consumer Reports. We're tracking just the same way you might find out which refrigerators conk out more quickly and which ones have the longest shelf life, as it were. We'll do the same thing. And there'll be a lot of short-term volatility, but over time you'll see over a 5, 10, 20 year period, certain strategies have done better than others. Now, as far as the trend, that's a particularly intriguing question that you ask. We did notice after 10, 15 years of doing this, that we found that the newsletter editors on balance were more bullish at some times and more bearish on others. It wasn't random. And that was the birth really of my contrarian shift in my thinking, which was that when you have this excessive bullishness on the part of the newsletter community, that was not a good sign for the market and vice versa. Now, it's not a very long-term predictor. It usually has, to the extent it works, it's over a couple month period, but it is interesting how people, when they become too bullish, the community as a whole, becomes way too bullish and vice versa. And so we have these swings from excessive bullishness to excessive bearishness. And if you can resist those trends, I found that over time you'll do better than you'll do by tracking the, at least the typical advisor.
Yeah. And when you talk about contrarian or, a type of investing, which is, and I'll just repeat it, and then I got a question that lead up to it. But basically, when things look super bullish, that means usually we might have a correction coming, and vice versa on that. Things are really, really low. You might have say, okay, we've got some potential opportunity. Now, in March of 2020, when we're at the bottom after that very quick and abrasive sell-off, I know in a couple of your articles, you had looked at that and you were saying, hey, when we have this type of sell-off, usually you're going to have, and if I remember it right, you were kind of looking at the data saying that there's going to potentially be another sell-off at some point to, I guess, kind of balance all that out as we started to climb back out of that. What are you seeing on that now? Has it changed? Is it different because of a pandemic or because of what the government's doing? Are you seeing that might change those numbers?
Yeah, well, it's a good question, and it's a good reminder of how the markets humble all of us, but especially me. So, you know, I was definitely wrong. I thought when the market took off in April and May, I said that, you know, I expected a retest of the lows. Obviously, we've not gotten that retest of the lows. But one, I mean, just to start, so Contrarian Analysis actually did a relatively good job in March and February and January, the first 3 months of the year. So in fact, at the market high, right before the market started turning down in late February, there was more bullishness than among the timers we track, market timers, than almost any other time over the last 20 years. Now, you couldn't say Contrarian Analysis predicted that a pandemic would, you know, lay low the market, but you could say, as indeed you just said in your question, that given the fact that there was that excessive bullishness, it's unlikely that the market will keep going. And then at the March lows, there was excessive bearishness. There's no doubt about it. We all recall, this is relatively recent in memory, just how terrible it felt on the March 23rd lows, for example. And indeed, the market took off. So that's, Contrarian Analysis did okay in those two particular points, both the high and the low. But subsequently to that, I'd say that at a minimum, the jury is still out, or it just, you could say it was just plain wrong. There have been a number of weeks over the last month or two where we've seen excessive bullishness on the part of the advisors we track. And maybe what we're seeing yesterday and today is evidence of finally the market succumbing to that excessive bullishness, who knows? But the market had continued higher, as you know, for the last 4 or 6 weeks in the face of that excessive bullishness. So I draw a couple lessons from that. One is no system works all the time. And secondly, even when it does work, it doesn't necessarily succumb immediately. We've seen in the past up to a 2 or 3 month period of a lag between excessive bullishness and bearishness in the market finally succumbing. So this is not unprecedented, but I will say that I, as you say, predicted that the market would pull back, and at least until now, we haven't really seen it.
Yeah, on that point, while we're on, you know, what has happened thus far in 2020 amidst COVID-19 and the market sell-off, the March lows, and then the recovery that we have seen, you know, I think a lot of advisors, us included, and regardless of what strategy that you're running, a lot of us thought pretty much exactly what you did. You know, the economy not doing well, a lot of companies struggling amongst the shutdowns. But one major thing happened that was completely unexpected. It's never happened before. And that's the Fed and the action that the Fed has taken over the past 5 months. So what are your thoughts on that as far as what they've been doing? Because ultimately, you know, you probably, good chance you would have been right if the Fed didn't do what they have done so far. So what are your thoughts on all that?
Right. Well, you know, this is always the problem with trying to use historical data, because as you say, this is something that's so unprecedented that this is where history doesn't really help us much at all. I mean, it makes perfect sense to me that you throw $5 trillion or whatever the amount of the increase of their balance sheet into the economy, a lot of it's going to find its way in the stock market. That makes me think, well, yes, the market still has a long way to go. On the other hand, you start looking at some of the prognostications for earnings and the uncertainty that businesses still face. And, you know, the way to put it, there's a lot of known unknowns. And then, of course, there are a lot of unknown unknowns. And it doesn't take much imagination to think that it doesn't take more than one or two of them to sabotage the market. So, you know, I think that way, then I think, well, yes, the market or at least the economy as a whole will struggle until some of those uncertainties are resolved. So, you know, I can see it on both sides. I guess I'm a little wary of saying, you know, because the Fed's doing something they've never done before, that, you know, that all bets are off that would otherwise come from a historical analysis, because that then slips very easily into saying this time is different. And those, as we know, are the four most dangerous words on Wall Street. So I'm a little wary of going there. But on the other hand, you know, you're absolutely right that it is unprecedented. But, you know, you can look at any situation and say it was unprecedented. You go to back to 2008. Of course, nothing had quite happened like that before either. And so everyone's always looking at history to try to draw the particular analogies that, that make the most sense. The one that I find myself, you know, again, this is just my commentary, not my data analysis, but that makes most sense to me is that the economy responds to uncertainty. I mean, businesses hate uncertainty, and we have uncertainty that's off the maps right now. And that's not just anecdotal or subjective. There's an index that out of Stanford and University of Chicago and Northwestern called the Economic Policy Uncertainty Index. And it's now more than double its highest level at any other time back to 1900. They backdated the index all the way back to 1900. And it's based on a very objective read of newspaper stories and things like IRS regulations and the Federal Register. It's a fairly sophisticated index. And they've gone back and correlated the Economic Policy Uncertainty Index with the gross domestic product and find that not a big surprise, but they've been able to show it statistically that the economy will respond downward to heights, to increases of uncertainty and vice versa. So it seems to me that the Fed can maybe postpone a bigger drop, and no doubt they did, but they can't in and of themselves overcome that uncertainty. And until that uncertainty is resolved, I think the next couple of years are far more risky than I think the market right now is betting. Though maybe the last couple of days when the market's finally having a little bit of a correction, maybe they're saying, oh my gosh, maybe that uncertainty is a bit of a problem after all. Who knows?
Yeah. So we're actually just for anyone who's listening, we're recording this and doing this interview here the 1st of September. So I've got a question now kind of about the remainder of the year. We've obviously got an election this year. We've still got to deal with the pandemic, potential of a surge again on those numbers as we get into October, November timeframe. What do you see? I mean, if you had to look at from a pure, you know, data perspective, first of all, let me ask this. What's the data around an election? I mean, do you see that, you know, does it matter necessarily whether you have a Republican or a Democrat elected? I mean, have you done much on that kind of a research?
Yeah, I have looked at it. I mean, there are a million ways of slicing and dicing the data, as I'm sure you know and you've read, but one thing that I think is very helpful from a data point of view are these betting markets that allow you to bet on these electronic futures. They're called all or nothing futures contracts, and you can bet on an outcome. And since it's either pays 100 cents on the dollar or zero, depending on the outcome, the price of those contracts at any given time reflect the market's assessment of what the odds are of that outcome. And so these contracts, for example, a Biden win or a Trump win, there have been, you know, contracts tied to each of those outcomes. You can track their prices now going back a year and correlate that with the market. And there have been times when Biden's, look at his contract in particular, the odds of winning have gone way up, and then they've come way back down the last couple of weeks. And you try to see whether there is any a consistent relationship between those changes in the Biden contract and the market, and you just don't see it. So I've written a couple of columns on this, that if, for example, President Trump is saying that if he loses, you can kiss your 401ks goodbye or whatever saying he said, if that were really true, or let's maybe put it a different way, if investors really thought that were true and Biden's chances go up significantly, you'd expect the market to tank, and you just haven't seen it. If anything, you've actually seen a slight correlation between the Biden's chances of winning going up and the market going up. And so that isn't to say that's cause and effect. We all know that correlation is not causation. But I would just say that if indeed there were any chance of your 401ks going to zero in an event that could happen within 2 months, and you saw a big increase in probability of that event, you would probably see a huge drop in the market whenever that increase in the Biden contract. So I would say that, that's not to say that investors don't care about politics or the market doesn't care about it, but I think it's far more mixed and nuanced than people think. And so I would not, I think there's a lot of other uncertainty that could more easily sabotage the market. I mean, I think the nightmare scenario that we're facing right now is the prospect that we don't know who's going to win the election for not just a couple of weeks, but a month or two after the election. And if you think we are facing economic policy uncertainty now, which undeniably we are, put on top of that the fact that we don't even know who's going to be running the White House, and you have Bush versus Gore all over again, squared or cubed, I mean, that would just cause, I think, businesses just to basically stop all innovation, stop all capital investment. The economic environment would be so uncertain that they just say we can't proceed. And I think those things are much more likely to cause the market to fall. So, on the other end, the market is betting that we'll resolve these things all to the upside. And it's always dangerous to bet that the market is wrong. But I don't think it would take much evidence to the contrary that there's more uncertainty than they were imagining for the market to drop. And that, again, may be what we're seeing over the last couple of days.
Yeah. So how would you see that? How do you think you think December 31st, are we going to be positive, negative, the market? That is, what would you think?
Relative to where we are now? Is that the question?
Yeah.
I was afraid you'd ask me that question. I always bet that the market will probably be a bit higher. I mean, just because historically that's the most intelligent bet over any given time. And so for my 401k, which I still have at Dow Jones, even though they shut down my newsletter, I still have it there. It's invested, and I don't try to play the market. And I felt pretty bad on March 23rd. I'm feeling a lot better right now than I did then. It'll still be invested on December 31st. But I think that's always the bet. But if you ask me if I'm worried that it won't be, I think there's a not insignificant chance that the market could be a lot lower. I mean, that really in the end is what, we're people in the market are compensated for taking that risk. If there were no risk, then you wouldn't see a higher return from equities than you would from other assets. So I guess right now, another way to put it is I'm feeling very much the risk for which I'm getting compensated.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. It's quite the uncertain time right now. So I'd like to transition just a tiny bit. I've read quite a few of your articles over the years as well. And every now and then you talk about these sentiment indexes that you've created. Consumer sentiment has a big impact on what the markets are doing, where people are buying in the markets. Can you take us through, what led you to create the Hulbert sentiment indexes, and then, what the purpose is behind those?
Oh, absolutely. So as I mentioned earlier, after about 10, 15 years of my doing this, so that would be since I started in 1980, maybe mid 90s or a little bit later, I started noticing these consistent trends towards excessive bullishness and excessive bearishness. If sentiment didn't play a role, then you'd expect that you'd have the same percentage of investment newsletters and market timers bullish or bearish at any given time, but that was just not the case. So for example, in the late 90s, right at the height of the internet boom, you saw a lot of bullishness. I mean, and we all remember that bullishness. And then at different times, you also seen excessive bearishness. And so that, that was what was really the spark that led me to invent these sentiment indices, because I had all this data. So I was already tracking all these advisors. I was tracking about 200 newsletters, and between them, they had about 600 separate portfolios or strategies. So we had a fairly, you know, deep database that we could look at what was the average exposure to the market on any given day. And so we started offering that to clients. Would you be interested in an index that would change every day? It would tell you the most up-to-date average exposure to the market. And that's what we've done. Now, we've done a number of statistical studies of them over the years. And I want to stress, A, what I was saying earlier, they're not always right. So don't ever think to the contrary. And B, even when they're right, they're a very short-term tool where it looks like the average time horizon over which they have their greatest explanatory power is no more than about 3 months. So if you're a long-term investor, this is of perhaps good interest. It allows you to not get swept up in whatever is sweeping Wall Street in any given time. And that there is some value in not getting swept up in that, as you know. But I wouldn't use it as a basis for investing, except for the following. Let's say that you had some money that you were trying to decide when to invest in your 401k, or you had to decide when to start taking money out. Let's say you had to pay for a college tuition or a down payment on a house. It might be worthwhile to put new money in at the point of maximum pessimism in the market, because more likely it's going to be a low price, and take money out when optimism is high. So what that would have told you is don't take your money out of the market on March 23rd. You should more likely put money in then. Of course, that's the last thing anyone wanted to do, but that's the point of contrarian analysis, is that you do things not because your heart says you wants to do it, but because your head tells you it's a good time. Likewise, last couple of weeks would have been a great time to take money back out of the market, just because we're at periods of excessive bullishness. So that would be the only way in which I think a long-term investor might be able to put some of these sentiment indicators to use. But as I say, they're very short-term indicators, but they are, it's very regular. The market oscillates back and forth between extremes of fear and greed. Again, I'm not the first to point that out. I think what I contribute to the discussion is that I have data that allow for an objective assessment of those extremes of fear and fear and greed. There are a lot of people who claim to be contrarian, but I don't think they have an objective basis on which to claim when they say they see excessive bullishness or bearishness. I remember, this is a number of years ago, but I was the MC of one of these investment seminars where lots of different newsletter editors would get up and talk. And I kid you not, every single one of the people on one panel discussion I was leading all claimed that they were contrarian, all claimed that they were now going to say something that no one else ever believed. And that meant that each one of them was right. Well, of course, they all contradicted each other. And I think that contrarian analysis in that kind of thinking is just is an excuse for sloppy thinking, really. I mean, you know, I want to be bullish, I don't want to be a contrarian, so therefore I'm going to claim everyone out there is bearish. And somebody else says, well, I want to be a contrarian, but I'm bearish, I'm going to claim everyone's out there is bullish. And you can always find plenty of pockets of bullishness or bearishness, even if it's, you have to look hard. So you need an objective basis for whatever the consensus is before you can truly be a contrarian with discipline.
Yeah. So a lot of good thoughts. We appreciate your input on all these questions that we're asking you. So how often do you write articles? Is there you do a certain amount of articles that you post or that you write? Do you have like one a week, or how does that work?
Well, I write for a number of different publications, but it turns out to be about once a day. Most of them appear on MarketWatch. I write 4 times a week for MarketWatch. And then once a month for Barron's and once a month for the Wall Street Journal. And then I write periodically for TheStreet.com, and also write for a new service that is called Callaway Climate Insights. It's a brand new service that's created by the former editor-in-chief at MarketWatch, and he now is creating his own service with a focus on climate. So I write for all of those. And so, you know, there are lots of different places, but I'd say the main place you can find my stuff is at MarketWatch.
So can you, if you want to go find, let's say, a library of your articles, can you just go to MarketWatch and search you that way?
Absolutely. Yeah, just put my name in the search bar and then you can get, you know, I suspect it goes back years. I don't know how long it goes, but you can see the full archive.
Well, very good. Well, we appreciate it. And I enjoy reading your articles. And now maybe other folks will go out there and search you and read these articles, because they certainly do give us a different way of thinking. That's the way I look at it. It's a very, very interesting. And so I truly appreciate you buying out some time here and coming on this on our podcast and having a good conversation with us.
Well, it's been my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
All right. Thank you. Have a good day.